So good morning, everybody. This is the moment of truth. Lovely, lovely girl. The second, by the way. That's the middle one. At least the screen seems to be working. Can you hear me in the back? Raise your hand if you cannot hear me. Yeah, the oldest joke in the book. All right. Where did Dima go? He was supposed to listen. Right. So good morning, everybody. I hope that you're feeling fine, energized, fresh. I'm not. We had a bit of a late night last night, so I'm feeling a bit, how should I say, tired would be the politically correct word. Some of you have probably met me on Twitter. That's my living room. But there's another set of rooms in my digital house. So if you go to my blog, you will see the longer explanation of this talk with a little bit more details and more references and so on. And if you go to SlideShare, even today, you can get the slides for today's talk. There's a small difference between what you're going to see here and what's up on SlideShare, and that's the bonus for you guys to be here. So thanks for coming. Who am I, besides bribing Dima to tell good things about me? So I used to live in a country that looked pretty much like this. Sun, beach, warm. And then at some point, for some reason, I ended up moving to a country that looked like this. So the first one was Portugal and the second one was Finland. Why did we move here? On the other hand, I'm really glad we did, because actually that is the reason I am here. A lot of the things I've learned and the experiences I have collected happened in Finland. Still a little bit about myself. This is my first computer. Who's in the Spectrum crew? You guys rock. So this computer, actually, it was funny because we used to play those games, you know, when we were kids. We played a lot of games. Computer was not a work tool. It was just a fun tool. And the key and W keys would break so often because there was a plastic membrane underneath for the contact. And then we were playing the running games where you had to press very quickly the keys. So I went through, I don't know, 3 or 4 keyboard membranes in that machine. That's how I actually started getting interested in computers overall, to see what I was capable of doing with something as simple and as humble as a ZX Spectrum, and then growing from then and trying to figure out what can we do with this. And then I learned a lot about programming and so on, and then I was like completely excited about the internet. Whoa, you can talk to people on the other side of the world. And now here we are with Twitter. It's kind of talking to people on the other side of the world. It's just so quaint. Everybody does it. What do you mean you can talk to people on the other side of the world? All right, okay, now you can wake up. This is the end of the intro. So I do a couple of things when I'm nervous, and I'm always nervous when I talk in front of so many people. And if you see me walking from one side of the room to the other, that's because I'm nervous. Why do people do those things? I have a couple of things I always do before the talk. So one of those is like try to go through the slides in my head like 15 times per minute until the talk starts and try to remind myself of some tricks to cool down. Any Zen Buddhists around? One incognito. So there's a lot of tricks you can do to kind of cool your mind, to kind of converge in a thought, to focus, right? Those are called superstitions. I'm a big football fan. Peter Schmeichel was one of my favorite players of all times. And he had this thing, every time, Peter Schmeichel, by the way, those of you that are not old enough, is a goalkeeper, and he played in Manchester United. Manchester United, at least you might know, no? Okay. So he used to do these things, that he would go to one side of the goal, and he would grab the pole, with his both hands, he would put his head against the pole. Now the microphone is doing something funny. Can you still hear me? Okay. He would put his head against the pole and he would kick it 3 times. Then he would go all the way to the other. He would do the same and he would kick it 3 times. And then he would go to the middle. He would do whatever. And then he was ready. That's just a trick, right? It's a superstition. You do it because you believe it will help you, right? Some people start up V and then program in Eclipse. That was, no? Okay, not too technical crowd, all right, sorry. Joke didn't catch. But what those superstitions do for us is that for those of us that are the most inquisitive, they make us ask questions. Wait a second, why does bumping your head against a pole and kicking it 3 times helps you concentrate? Why does that happen? And those that are curious will try to figure out why that happened. So there was this one guy, lived quite near here. I mean, if you think about the globe, the guy was Galileo. And he started looking at the moon and he said, there's something weird here. It doesn't seem like the Earth is at the center of the universe. And then he used the technology, which we now call telescopes. He perfected that technology and he started to ask questions about the universe. Why is it so? Right? That's a very powerful question, although not very easy in certain situations. So if you happen to find yourself in medieval Europe, please don't go against the Pope because you might end up in the fire. And that's almost what happened to Galileo. One of the brightest minds in our European culture and science almost got burned because he said the truth. Can you imagine getting burned because you say the truth? It did happen. Yeah. So this was the simple object that drew Galileo's attention to what was going on. And he asked the questions, why is this happening? Why do we have these superstitions? Why don't we just explore this? So that's what I want to do today. And I want to do it by starting to say that there are still people with these superstitions. There are still people who cannot see the world for what it is. This is the Flat Earth Society's website and an artist's rendition of what the flat earth would look like. They still can't explain how you can go from this bit here to that bit there with one step. This. Anyways, so this Flat Earth Society actually exists and is dedicated to furthering the belief that the earth is flat instead of an oblate spheroid. It actually exists. There are people doing this. There are people who actually there are researchers trying to prove that the Earth is flat. Obviously, anyone that has seen the movie Apollo 13 knows it's not flat, obviously. Otherwise, how could they get that shot from the moon? You guys are slow today, too. Anyway, but we have a lot of these superstitions in our work. So these are just some methods of estimation. I'm pretty sure that if we would spend 5 minutes here, we could come up with maybe 100 types of estimation. So we have expert estimation. Ask the guy with the loudest voice. Cue, silence, cue.
We're slow.
No, it's not. I'm the one that is tired. Consensus estimation, function point analysis, and so on. And all of these are just time estimates. Then there's a whole new population of estimation techniques that are all about cost. There's so much science and literature written about estimations that you could probably stack it up and go all the way to the moon. But there's a problem with this, right? The only way that you can estimate is if you can look into the future. When was the last time you successfully did that?
Tell them I'm not here.
Sorry?
People tell you, but I'm not.
Yes, thanks, John. We should have an image now of a phone and a knife and slowly. Okay. That's the point, is that estimation actually requires you to look into the future. You can't estimate without looking into the future. You can't estimate without making assumptions about the future. You can't estimate without imagining how history will go. It's not possible. It's called precognition. Knowledge of a future event or situation, especially through extrasensory means. I see dead people. Did you see the movie? That's what extrasensory means. What you're seeing is dead versions of the future. all the time when you're trying to estimate. But there's a further problem with estimation and precognition, is that the indisputed fact is that we are very bad at predicting the future. But that is not all, because actually lately, in the field of computer science, one area of study has become very popular. It's called complexity sciences. How many of you have heard about complexity? Another trick question, how many of you have heard about Scrum? All right, so for your information, Scrum is supposed to be a method to deal with complex situations, which is funny because actually one of the key aspects of complexity is the admission that we cannot predict the future. It's the admission that causality can only be assessed in retrospect. That's a form of what we call retrospective coherence. Retrospective coherence is when you're in the future looking at the past and then you can explain exactly what happened, right? Have you noticed that when the project ends, everybody was right about the estimation? If you were right then, why did you wait until the end, right? And the reason is simple, is that it's pure retrospective coherence. You can't know the future until you are in the future. And then you make up this story, which is very common for us humans. That's why we create those superstitions and everything. It's very common for us to go back and explain everything that happened from the point of view of the future, when you're there, right? So there's a big problem with estimation. It requires us to have extrasensory senses, meaning that you can see things that no one else can see, dead people. It requires us to know about the future with certainty, some certainty, which, given that we are trying to work in a complex environment, at least those of us that are trying to do Scrum are admitting that they are working in a complex environment, then you can't do that. You can't predict cause and effect before it actually happens. So you have to look at estimation in a completely different way. This little guy here is a butterfly, very colorful. And some of you have heard of the term butterfly effect, right? Butterfly effect is when a design decision you made 5 years ago completely screws your deployment 5 years later. That's a very concrete example of the butterfly effect. And this further emphasizes the point that actually there's so many things at play when we are doing a software project. And the bigger the project, the more complex and the more unknowns you have, that it's just foolish to try to think that you can actually predict the future. So the big question for us is, especially for Scrum, is are we managing a process that happens in a complex environment? Or are we managing a process that happens in an ordered environment where causality can be assessed upfront, where we know the future in simple terms? So if Scrum is a process that will excel in a complex environment, then we should not be estimating because it's impossible to predict the future. If Scrum is not a process that can succeed in a complex environment, then why the hell do we say it does, right? And the funny thing is that we have people selling you the idea that complex, that Scrum is adequate for a complex environment, i.e. where you cannot assess causality. And those same people are making bundles of money selling you estimation techniques. This is internally incoherent. They don't play together. Either you believe you're in a complex environment or you don't believe you're in a complex environment. Doing both is madness. At least you're selling snake oil, that's what I mean. So, obviously, now we are faced with a difficult question. I still need to go to my boss and tell him when I think the project is going to end, because otherwise he ends me, right? What? You don't know if it takes 1 day or 5 years? What the hell are you talking about? Okay, that's an exaggeration, but you get the point. So we have to look for an alternative. We have to figure out how can we, with any measure of certainty, look at what we are doing and try to predict when it's going to be done. And this is a very critical business decision, by the way. It has nothing to do with software. So those of you that spend a lot of time designing software, doing some architecture, doing some research to try to estimate the project, you're doing it wrong. Because this is purely about business. Estimation only has one use, to inform a business decision. Because when you actually start developing the software, the estimation is out the window anyway. It always happens differently than what you expect, right? So what could we find that would help inform business decisions? So I have a very simple solution. And by simple, I mean that anyone can use it, even those that have used the previous estimation techniques. And that is just count the amount of work done and average that out over a long period of time and then project that and see where it ends. For us in the Agile community, it's even better because if you're doing requirements, you're screwed anyway. But if you're doing user stories, you have this little vertical slices of functionality that are independent from each other. So actually, it makes sense to count them. It makes sense to see how many pieces of value, pieces of functionality we can deliver over a period of time, and then use that to inform a business decision, like a roadmap decision. Do we start a project or not? Do we release this product with that functionality or that functionality? This is a completely new product. Are we even going to be on time in the market? Those are very important decisions that need to be informed with some form of understanding of how you will deliver or when you will deliver. So this is a very simple. These are the two contrasting approaches, if you will, in my presentation. One, story points, requires you to spend time estimating the stories up front. And one, just count the number of stories completed, which does not require you to estimate the stories up front. And I'll explain that in a little bit more detail. So those are the two contrasting. So now that I know what I want to prove, I can ask a few questions. I can be curious. Does it work? Maybe it doesn't. So question number one, is there sufficient difference between what story points and number of items completed measure to say that they don't measure the same thing? Are they measuring different things? Then which one of the two metrics is more stable? Because I don't know about you, but for my product managers, they are actually quite keen on knowing the stability or at which you, or let's put it this way, the rate at which you deliver value, because that helps them think about the product. If you say that, yeah, okay, this sprint we delivered one user story, next sprint we might deliver 15 user stories, then he's totally lost, right? It's very hard to do any sort of even planning on that. You've heard about the grooming meeting or the 5% meeting in Scrum, where you look a little bit into the future and say, okay, these are the stories that are coming up next. Let's explore them a little bit, write the acceptance criteria and so on. If you don't know if you're delivering one or 15, it's very hard to do those meetings. So that was question number two. And then question number three is more of a practical question. Are they so close that actually measuring one is the same as measuring the other? Can they deliver the same amount of information? So I use data. So I asked on the internet for some people to deliver some data. In this presentation, I have 9 data sets. After I've done this presentation in a few other conferences, I've seen a few more coming in. And actually, the data is quite interesting. I'll show an example of that. I was not a stakeholder in any of this project, so that's one important point, because you could always argue that if you're a stakeholder in the project, you have a stake in making your approach succeed. I was not a stakeholder in any of these projects. Another thing that I've been asked when talking about this is that, oh yeah, but that only works because they actually estimated. So not all projects actually estimated story points necessarily. There's one. I will show an example of a project that did not estimate story points, but was able to anyway make a concrete, difficult business decision based on just counting the number of items. And the data came from different sized companies and different sized teams. So we have one team companies, we have 500 team companies, we have two guy team, we have 11 guy team, I think is the biggest. So we have quite different sets of data. And here's the data. The first 4 teams. What you see here on the blue line is the number of story points completed after each iteration. The red line shows the number of items completed at the end of an iteration. Obviously, the number of items is always lower than the number of stories, because a story might be 20 points or whatever, and that's only one item, right? So obviously, that's why the lines are different. I did not want to use different scale, because that doesn't make any sense. But then I started looking at this, and I found out, actually, the correlation is quite high. Isn't that weird? One would say that they shouldn't have, right? I mean, the basic question I'm asked all the time, but stories have different sizes, right? You have big stories, you have small stories. How can they be correlated? And when we started looking at the correlation, we actually found that it was pretty high. So 75 is actually not that high, but then we have 83, we have 92. There was one where the correlation was very, very low. But if you take out the last sprint, the correlation is in the 70s, so that's okay. I'm messing with the data there, so the correlation is actually low for that team, but it shows that, you know, with some outliers, actually the correlation can be quite high. Then I looked at more data, and we see again 88, 75, 75, 70. There's a very high correlation. Now, I do want to be clear about this. I'm not saying that the correlation is high in scientific terms, because it would have to be much higher than what this is in scientific terms. I'm saying that it is high in practical terms. If the correlation is 70 up, you know that there's very similar things that these two data points are, or data sets are measuring, the story points and the stories completed. So that's a 92, for example. So what were the conclusions? We have such a high correlation that it's very likely that both of these metrics actually measure the same underlying signal. They are probably telling you a very similar type of information. The normalized data has similar value of standard deviation, which means that regarding how stable it is, there's not very much difference. You can't say that story points are more stable than items, but you can't say the reverse either. But they do seem to measure the same thing. So what does that mean in practice? So the next step I took was, OK, they're not that far apart. So obviously, there must be a very good reason to use story points, right? So I went back to the source and looked at the claims that were made about why we should use story points. Here are the claims. You have the rest of the blog post there. You have the link there. And actually, I'm here only going to analyze the first four claims. If you want a little bit more in-depth, you can go to the blog. But these are the claims that Mike Cohn is the source for story point estimation and the planning poker technique. This is what he used. So let's go through this. Again, claims 5 and 6 you can see on the blog. So claim 1, it allows us to change story point estimation, allows us to change our mind whenever we have new information about the story. So you have a story point, let's say 20, and then you now have new information. Now you can change your mind. Funnily enough, there's no explanation how you do that. So there's no actual application of this claim. So if you read the book, we can't actually know what that means in practice. But on the other hand, if I just look at measuring the number of items completed, I can state that if you measure the number of items completed, you have immediate visibility of the impact of the new items in progress. So taking the same example, if you have here a story that you thought was 20 points, and then you start looking at it and say, actually, this story is far too large, so you break it down into 10 stories because it was really large, all right? Then you have a very large impact. And if this was your rate of completion, obviously by adding more stories, you now have a completely different landing date for the project. So if you just measure the number of items, yes, you can change your mind about a story when you have more information. And not only that, but you can see the immediate impact that that changing of mind has on the project. So you go to a product manager and says, actually, this story, which was just click a button and then poof, magically everything happens, actually it's a bit more complicated than that. And then he brings this law book, 500 pages, and say, 300 of these pages need to be in that algorithm, right? And oh, How many stories are those? And you can see the impact immediately. So previously it was one story, do a calculation, it's done, and now it's maybe 300 stories, one per page, whatever, I don't know. But you see the impact immediately. So in claim one, we can safely say story points add no value when compared to just counting the number of items completed. So claim two. Claim two is that story points are good because it works both for epics, very large stories, and for stories, like small things. So allowing for large items and in the backlog does help account for big pieces of work. Actually, it actually gives you a pretty good idea of the uncertainty that there is behind an epic that is about 100 story points, for example. There is some value in that, right? Because if you see something in the backlog that says 100 story points, you know, okay, we haven't touched it yet. It's like a cave somewhere and we haven't yet killed the wolf that stands in front. We still need to explore it. But of course, we have to acknowledge that an epic that is 100 story points can be either 100 one story point stories, or it can be 500 one story point stories, or it can be 200 story points epics. It can be of any size. So actually, classifying something as a 100 story points epic is very much the same as just saying this is too big. It's exactly the same. It's a measure of uncertainty. So yeah, this is valuable, right? But you have much simpler ways to do that. In your backlog, you can classify stories as understood and not understood, or high risk, low risk, or small and big. You can do that without having to go through the process of estimating 500 stories up front when the project starts. So, conclusion, there is no significant added information in classifying a story as a 100 story point story, or an epic as a 100 story point story. There is some information. What I'm saying is that there's no significantly added information. You could do the same by just labeling it as big, or risky, or big hairy wolf. And then there's another problem, which is that another aspect of this is that you can talk about the size of a story without being tied down to time, because that kind of puts you back and you're afraid of estimating and so on. So story points is kind of a metaphor, right? It's like the butterfly effect. It's a metaphor for something that is happening. And that might be socially better in your context to talk about story points, because it's kind of, we're not committing. I mean, it's a story point. It can be anything, you know? We're not saying it's 5 days. We're saying it's 500 story points. But there's one thing that every single team does when they start using story points, which is figure out the exchange rate. Every team does that. Why? Joseph knows better. Joseph, by the way, Joseph Pellerin helped me put this presentation together, and he had a very good explanation for that. What I understood of that is that when you're talking about estimation, you're using different parts of your brain. One part, which is the imaginative part of your brain, like the looking forward, creating pictures, writing, or creating stories of how the project will go. And then you have to bring all of that information back to the other side of the brain, which is the one that deals with numbers, with sizes, with concrete things. And that he called cognitive ping pong, trademark Joseph Pellerin. And what he tries to say is that those two things don't work very well together. Those two areas of the brain don't work very well together. So there's reason to believe that trying to do that actually reduces the fidelity of the information you've created about the future by trying to put it into some form of number, which is what you need to do if you're doing an estimation. So there's this cognitive ping pong problem here as well. So claim three doesn't take a lot of time. How many of you have heard that estimating with planning poker doesn't take a lot of time? It takes less time than estimating with Gantt charts and whatever. Only three people? So this claim was not even true before I started, right? For you, yeah. My experience with planning poker estimation, so one technique used to use story points as an estimation tool, is extremely boring for developers. Super boring. They really get mad at, why are you asking those questions? Yeah, he said 15, I said 13, who cares? Let's put 12 and a half. That's what actually happened. So a guy whom I value and admire a lot, Ken Power, applied what is a facilitation technique, the silent group technique, to estimating very large projects. And he said that they could estimate several hundred of stories in a couple of hours. That's pretty good. The question is, are we even trying to solve the right problem? Right. But okay, so coming to claim three, just the fact that you have to come up with silent group technique to estimate large projects actually invalidates claim three. It is not short. It is long and it's painful and it's boring. Right? So claim three doesn't hold either. You're starting to see a pattern, I hope. Now we get to the interesting part. Claim four provides useful information about our progress and the work remaining. So just to be very clear, this can only be true if and only if you have estimated all of your stories. If you think you can use story points without estimating the whole backlog, you're fooling yourselves. It doesn't help at all. If you have one story unestimated, you don't know what's going to happen. You can't use that. Claim four does not hold unless you have every single story estimated in your backlog. So think about it next time you have a 500 story project. But basing your progress in the progress assessment on the number of items completed for each sprint is much faster to calculate, right? Because you have the number of items in the backlog, you divide that by the number of items you complete on average per sprint, and there you go. You have the number of sprints left. It's easy. Actually, you don't need to estimate the project. You can come up with more sophisticated ways, like attributing a higher value to big stories or high-risk stories. You can do that if you want. My experience is that there's no added value in doing that. And I'll try to show that with a couple of examples. I do want to point out, before I go into the examples, that what I'm showing here, and I want to be very upfront with you about this, is only anecdotal evidence. From a scientific point of view, this just helps to explore new theories, new models. But we need a lot more data before this becomes, let's call it, accepted theory by everybody, right? I'm showing you a couple of examples, but we need more data. So I would really appreciate if you could share the data from your projects with me. I will publish all of the data in their raw format as well as my conclusions so that I can then allow everybody to do the same process, look at the data, and figure out whether it holds true or not. But please share that data. We really need to have a proper dialogue in the industry and in a community about this, because right now there's a lot of people paying a lot of money for things that are just pure superstition. Okay, so now we go for an example. This is a real story. This is a real project. The data that we collected had a very large impact on a business decision. Of course, the names have been removed to protect the innocent. I'll try to be very concrete about this. If you don't understand, please raise your hand because it's important that you do. So this is one project. This is our beta backlog. We need to do all of this before we can go to beta. Beta is important because it gives us feedback and then we can adapt to the customer's information or the customer's needs. And then that's the actual release. So we need to do all of that all the way up to 140 items almost in order to be able to have a successful product. Not only that, but we have concrete deadlines. We have a market window that we cannot miss. You know, 2-3 months that if you're not there, there's no point in doing that product because no one is going to want to buy it anyway. So we had a very clear market-driven deadline. Not a wild-ass guess about when this should be done. It was clear feedback from our customers. Either you have something by then or we're not buying from you, right? So that is a very important point. This is what the line of progress should be. So this is we should be here in order to meet the deadline, the market-driven deadline. And this is the same for the final release, right? This is the ideal or required progress rate. Every line here is one sprint. We have the evolution of velocity here in pink. And in the first sprint, we did one item. That was the first sprint. And this red line and that blue line over there, the ones that are almost flat, was the actual progress. doesn't look pretty. All right. So obviously, we had some very difficult conversations about the project. And we really did a lot of effort in cutting down the backlog items. We really made a lot of effort, the product management side did, to reduce the scope to the minimum we could honestly believe would be acceptable by the customer. Of course, now we know that was a mistake, but at that time we didn't know. And we were really making a huge effort to try to reduce the backlog. On the other hand, this is what happened. First sprint, 80 items. Second sprint, 95 items. Left. First sprint, 130 items. Second sprint, 165 items. Left to be done. Of course, our velocity did increase. It was no longer one, it was now eight. So we were eight times faster, one could say. So the progress line looks a lot better than it did before, but hey, a little bit of a gap here. So I was at that time, I was working with the product managers and I did a bet with them. But this project had been going on for a while and they had to make a decision. Do we actually do this project at all? So the history of the team stated that the velocity was 188, so we had data, first sprint 1, second sprint 8, third sprint 8. They were still learning the product. It was a new product, so they were still getting familiar with the technology stack and so on and so forth. So there was some, you know, getting up to speed assumption. We will go faster as we learn more, which is quite normal and quite acceptable. And they had committed, the team had committed to 15 items per sprint in the sprint planning meeting. So they said, we can do 15 items per sprint. Of course, not coincidentally, the product manager needed 15 items per sprint to be completed for the product to be delivered on time. Why I say not coincidentally is that even when you're in a negotiation situation and you have a person who is the product manager who's very good at extracting things from other people, and you have a group of people, the engineers, who's very good at giving people what they want, you have an unbalanced negotiation position, right? So it was no surprise that the team said, yeah, we can do 15. So the product owner and the team said, we can do 15 items per sprint. I would like the audience to think about this for a few seconds and then tell me how many they completed in the fourth sprint. So 1, 5, 15, 10, 5. Okay. So who, let's, oh, none, that was good. Who said five? Raise your hands. Would anyone like to explain why you said five?
I tried to do a lot of things together and failed to accomplish.
Try to do a lot of things together and then fail to accomplish. That's why you said zero, right? Because they start all 15 at the same time, just to be sure. And then, you know, the more you start, the less you finish. That's a reasonable train of thought. Very reasonable. Who said 10? Why did you say 10?
Because they learned something and they have a chance. 188, maybe next time a little bit better, but not.
That's a very good point. So they learned something and now they're trying hard, so they can do perhaps a little bit better. Actually, it's the exact opposite of the zero, which is that they actually try hard because they know a decision is going to be made. So they're going to do more. So my view is that one of these will be the truth. Either they really try hard and they do too much and they complete nothing, or they really try hard and they complete more, but not much more, right? One of these is, it seems reasonable, but expecting the velocity to double in one sprint without any evidence is wishful thinking. Just like the Pope before he almost killed Galileo. Yeah, the Earth is at the center of the universe. And I can sell you a very good training on why that is. So reality sinks in and they did 10 items. 20% increase in velocity, quite good actually, but my view is that velocity would not be sustainable because the teams would be not able to push hard from now until the end of the project. This was several months before the end of the project, about 4 months before the beta, and about 9 months before the actual release. The progress line now looks a lot better, but there's still a big gap. And there's one thing I didn't talk about, which of course some of you are already thinking of, which is that there's no way the backlog is ever going to be smaller than what it was at the beginning. Anyone that has worked in one software project knows one truth. At the beginning, you don't know anything. So obviously, from a product perspective, that means that there will be a lot more stuff put into the backlog as the project goes. Although the product management did do a very large effort in reducing the size of the backlog, they did spend also a lot of effort in that, but there was no way that the product could be completed. So the X came down and they said, okay, we're not going to do this product. This was about 25 people project, 9 months ahead of release. Multiply 25 salaries by 9 months and think about the amount of money that was saved. But better yet, think about the amount of knowledge and work that was invested into the product that is now making the most money for the company. They could have lost the product that is now making them money if they would have continued this project. But they didn't do that. They took the people out of that project that was going to fail pretty clearly, and they put it into a project that they thought was going to make them money. And it was already live, so they just needed to improve it, right? A lot less risk. So a clear business decision with significant impact in a company, at that time a mid-sized company, now a little bit bigger. Clear impact in a company, no story point used whatsoever. No effort on estimation done whatsoever, but a proper business decision made, right? So if estimation is used to inform business decisions, but you can make those business decisions without needing to estimate, the conclusion has to be. There's another aspect to this. What we release to customers are not story points. What is a 20 story points for you might be pretty useless for your customer. What we release to customers is story points. I see a lot of people with Macs here that should be paying attention to the talk. Sorry. I couldn't resist. Macs have a problem from my point of view. They don't have a delete key. I really hate to have to go to the end of the word to then delete. It's stupid, right? But they don't have a delete key. Yeah, you can do function backspace and that's a delete. But hey, most users don't know because it's not there, right? Usability king. So the idea is that actually a story that would be add the delete key into the keyboard would be something that is valuable for me. It might be 500 story points for you, but I don't care. I'm the customer, right? I have the money. I want the product with that functionality. If you can tell me when you're going to deliver the delete key, I might want to buy your product. If the only thing you can tell me is, well, actually, we think we can deliver 500 story points by that time, but we are unsure if we can deliver that story because actually there are other stories that need to be delivered and they might conflict with the one you want. And who cares? You're the customer. You don't pay for story points. You pay for stories. Complete user value that you can use immediately. Not wait to be deployed and then maybe the guy is sick and then we can't deploy it and it has to wait for the new server that's coming in, right? We buy stories, not story points. So why the hell are we estimating story points? Doesn't make any sense. So okay, just a very quick brief on why this works. When doing the backlog grooming or sprint planning, just ask one question. Can you do this story in one sprint? If the answer is no, break it into two. If the answer is still no, break it into two. And just do this over and over again. So yeah, some people will say, I'm already predicting the arguments, that this is a form of estimation. Yes, it is a form of estimation. But it's only for the stories that you're going to work on. That big 500 story point epic that is there, down there in the backlog, don't worry about it. You don't need to. Right? That's what I'm trying to say. For large projects, you can use a further level of abstractions that you can have stories that you can do in one sprint, and then you can have epics that fit into meta sprints. Let's say releases, for example. One epic must fit into a release. Do you believe it fits into a release? I'm not sure. Okay, break it in half. Do you now believe you can fit this into a release? I'm okay, but I'm not really confident. Okay, break it in half until you get something that you're confident that you can deliver in a release. This is really for large projects, right? Don't do that unless you have large projects. This is the consequence of doing that. What you're doing is constantly harmonizing the size of the stories that you're doing, and you get something like this when you look at the actuals. That's a Gaussian distribution. Everyone knows that when you have a Gaussian distribution, the median or the average, depends on what you want to do with accuracy, is the one that you should follow. So actually, when you have a Gaussian distribution, everything is the same size over a long period of time. Not for the next sprint, but over a long period of time. So, assuming that normal distribution, and for the purposes of looking at the long term, don't forget, we're talking about business decisions, not whether we should add this button here or change the color there. That's not why this is useful, right? Business decisions. For the purpose of looking at the long term, you can assume that all of the stories are the same size, because you have this process of breaking down stories into smaller things and so on. So therefore, you can measure progress by simply measuring the number of items completed per sprint. But there's more. I added one more question as a bonus for this amazing conference. So I got this question a lot, but which one is more accurate? And I was curious, right? And again, disclaimer, we're doing some anecdotal evidence here. We need more data. So we have a long project, 24 sprints, and we looked at which metric predicted most accurately the output of the whole project when you take into account only the first three sprints or only the first five sprints? Why three or why five? Okay, three, because it's very easy to convince someone to say, hey, just wait a month and a half and we'll tell you when we're done. That's okay, or wait 3 weeks and we'll tell you when we're done. That's okay, people will accept that, because the requirements analysis and the architecture phase and the design phase used to take 6 months anyway, so that's a gain for them. And why five is, okay, there's an argument to be made that you can get more accurate if you have more data. So I was looking into that as well. So again, disclaimer, this is only one project. We need more data, so please share your data with us. After three sprints, story points, predictive power, number of stories, predictive power, which approach do you think was more accurate?
Yours.
Story points.
Yours.
Actually, it's not mine, by the way, because a lot of people have been using this. I'm just the one putting a voice on it, kind of the megaphone. So, story points was actually quite accurate. The true output was 349.5. Don't ask why the half is there, but they used it. The predicted output, if you looked at the first three sprints and put the story points together and just expanded that, was 418. That's a 20% offset. And in just counting the number of stories, they did 228 stories. Predicted output was 220. So actually, the output predicted was 4% less than what they actually did. But it then gets more interesting. Just after five sprints, story points gets better. Now the error is about 13% plus. And this is, I don't know why that happened, but this happened. Same thing, minus 4%. So we could say from this that actually story points increase in predictive capability or accuracy as you count more sprints together. But the evidence does not support the idea that you need a lot of sprints to be accurate with just counting the number of stories.
If you keep using it, you'll get better.
Story points, yes.
But I don't see an improvement there.
There's no improvement here. So that was the fourth question. That was the bonus question for this conference that I looked at the data. Again, disclaimer, this is anecdotal evidence. We need more data. I'm not suggesting you stop the way you're working, which is accepted by everybody else in the company immediately. But I do suggest that you really look close at the data in your own projects and check whether this applies to you. Because if it does, you're wasting huge amounts of time doing something that doesn't add any value. So, thank you very much. Please give feedback before you leave the room. And I, of course, want to mention Joseph Pellerin, who was also a key contributor to this talk. So thank you very much. And I will take questions if there is time. Is there time? There is time? OK. So we have time for some questions. It's over there.
One question about dividing stories into smaller stories. How we can manage that story won't be splitted into technical tasks, and these will reduce it to technical tasks, which just can be managed in one story point, all story points, but in some kind of technical tasks?
That's a very good question. So how can you help break down a story, or how can you break down a story without it losing all contact with customer value and becoming just change this configuration line in the configuration file and then run these tests? That's a very good point. There's a lot of people working on that. There's a lot of people with technical knowledge that are working on that, that can help you to do that. So I would say get somebody who knows how to do it and get them to work with you. And why I say that is that I could, of course, sell you a 10,000 euro course on how to split stories so that they don't become technical stories. But I think that would not be the best use of your money. If you hire a coach that knows how to code and understands this concept, you will get a lot more result out of that, because the coach will bring in also other concepts and will help the team separate from the code and think about the big picture, the customer, what kind of value are we trying to deliver, and so on. So I know it's possible, I've seen it done, but it really requires experience.
Hi, I have a question. Do you have any information on the projects that you use, the data that you use, if they were like greenfield development, or if they were like brownfield or legacy development?
So brownfield versus greenfield, good question.
And did you see any kind of differences in that?
So there's a lot of projects I don't even know what kind of color field they were in, because I just got the data. So it's anonymous data in that sense. The example that I give about the product owner and the development team fighting about the estimates and so on, that's actually a greenfield project. But a lot of the data that I share in the earlier slides is from just incremental release projects. So as far as I can see, there's no big difference between greenfield versus incremental releasing. Good. Can I buy the number of items estimation tool, and is it open source and so on? Yeah, I'm starting a certification. I will be selling certificates at 2,000 euros per person. It's really good. It's 2 days, but then you really know how to do it. Yeah.
Okay, there is another role for user stories estimation in story points. It's to give stakeholders the ability to prioritize stories in front and to deduce backlog, for example. So what about?
Yeah, so the question was stakeholders also need some more information than just what the story is so that they can make prioritization. That might be true in your case. I'm not saying it isn't, but in my experience with product management and product owners, being hopefully in contact with product manager, we should focus a lot more on value. What is valuable for our customer, rather than is this a big technical risk or not? Because that information will surface immediately when you start working on that story, then that information will surface. On the other hand, don't forget that what I'm trying to do here is to present an approach that serves long projects, you know, more than a couple of sprints, right? So 10, 15, 20, 40 sprints, whatever. And in that context, the fact that one story is very valuable but also very hard to do is not that relevant. Right? For one, the next sprint, that's very relevant information because, you know, are we going to fail the next sprint or not? That's very relevant information. But if you look at the whole project with, let's say, 100 stories, it doesn't make sense to worry about the size of every single one of those stories, which is what the story point estimation technique does. It would be much more efficient to just cluster those stories into hard and easy, or high risk, no risk, or completely change the architecture, just add small stuff to the product. Whatever is the most important decision criteria for your project. And you can do that very easily without having a five-hour discussion about the story point number behind one story, which has happened to me and which is totally useless, but we continue to do in many teams. So think about the context, right? Because for the next sprint, that information is useful. But in a big project, is it really useful? It might be, but think about it.
Regarding the question of will the piece of work, the story, fit into the next sprint, and if it will or won't, if it won't, then split it. Was there any correlation in terms of the actual length of the sprints? Because clearly that makes a difference now. That's really the question you're pressing on. If half of those groups are doing 2-week sprints and half of the data was from 4-week sprints, is there any interesting patterns about looking into that difference?
I think that's an excellent question, which I would like others to look into, because I have a bias when I'm looking at that. But what I looked into the data is that you have teams with 1-week sprints, teams that have 1.5-week sprints, teams that have 2-week sprints. In the example that I showed, the one about the team that is kind of going into a project release and then decides to cancel the product, that example was 4-week sprints.